في الله، موضوع التعاون موضوع هام جدا، وموضوع أمر الله به في كتابه الكريم، فقال تعالى: وتعاونوا على البر والتقوى ولا تعاونوا على الإثم والعدوان. ومن تأمل وصف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لمجتمع الصحابة الكرام رضي الله عنهم وجده وصفا يدل على التعاون والتآخي، وأن المسلم في عون أخيه. يقول الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم: المؤمن للمؤمن كالبنيان يشد بعضه بعضا وشبك بين أصابعه. وقال الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم: مثل المؤمنين في توادهم وتراحمهم وتعاطفهم كمثل الجسد الواحد، إذا اشتكى منه عضو تداعى له سائر الجسد بالسهر والحمى. وقال الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم: المسلمون تتكافأ دماؤهم ويسعى بذمتهم أدناهم وهم يد على من سواهم. هذه وصف هذه الأحاديث فيها وصف للمجتمع المسلم، أنه مجتمع كالبنيان، كل لبنة فيه لها موضع وكل لبنة فيه لها مقام، فإذا اجتمعت هذه اللبنات كان البناء شامخا وكان البناء عاليا. المؤمن للمؤمن كالبنيان يشد بعضه بعضا، والمؤمن أيضا بين إخوانه المؤمنين مثلهم كالجسد الواحد، كل عضو في هذا الجسد له وظيفة، كل جهاز من أجهزة هذا الجسد له دور، لا يستقل جهاز عن جهاز ولا يستغني عضو عن عضو. فإذا اجتمعت الأعضاء والأجهزة كان هذا الجسد حيا. فمثل المؤمن للمؤمن أنهم أعضاء في الجسم الإيماني الواحد، يعطيه الحياة ويعطيه الحركة ويعطيه التدفق ويعطيه الطمأنينة. مثل المؤمنين في توادهم وتراحمهم وتعاطفهم كمثل الجسد الواحد، إذا اشتكى منه عضو تداعى له سائر الجسد بالحمى والسهر. والمؤمن لأخيه المؤمن تتكافأ دماؤهم، تتكامل، ولا يستغني بعضهم عن بعض، ولا يستقل أحدهم بمفرده، لأنهم أمة من دون الناس، أمة من دون الناس. المسلمون أمة من دون الناس، بوحدتهم، بتعاونهم، بتميزهم، بمنهجهم، بأفكارهم، بهذا الدين الشمولي الكامل الذي لم يدع صغيرة ولا كبيرة في حياة الناس إلا أحصاها، وإلا بينها بيانا شافيا ووضحها توضيحا كافيا. كل ذلك يجعل هذه الأمة أمة متميزة مستقلة من دون الناس. المسلمون تتكافأ دماؤهم ويسعى بذمتهم أدناهم وهم يد على من سواهم، يد واحدة، لأنهم أمة واحدة، لأنهم أمة واحدة، فهم أمة من دون الناس.
Today, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to talk about the issue of mutual cooperation with one another. You may have to say that this topic of cooperating with one another is an extremely important topic for us to ponder over and to reflect. And it is an issue that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us to do in the Quran when he said, and cooperate with one another on righteousness and on fearing Allah. And do not cooperate with one another on that which is evil and you think. The Shaykh went on to say that whoever concentrates on this ayah and ponders over it with deep consideration, he will find that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to his companions, we receive this description of cooperation being shown to us over and over again. We will find that the society in which they built and the society in which they participated in was a society in which the people were cooperating with one another. There was the true brotherhood and everyone was pulling his weight. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has explained to us in so many hadith. For an example, the Prophet has told us in an authentic hadith when he said, the believer to another believer is like a solid cemented structure. And then the Prophet went on to put his fingers together like this and he said, each one of them solidifies the other. And then the Shaykh went on to say, also we have in another hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us, verily the example of the believers in their love for one another and in their mercy towards one another and in their being kind and soft towards one another is like the example of the body. If one part of the body aches, the rest of the body will suffer from fever and sleepless nights. He went on to say in another hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when he said that the Muslims are equal in their blood, all of their blood are equal across the board. There's no one whose blood is more expensive than the next person. All of their blood are the same in terms of its price. He said that they go out to help one another and they are one hand against those people who are against them. The Shaykh went on to say in these hadith and other hadith we find the true characteristic of the Islamic society, the society that's built upon Iman and Islam, and that is the characteristic of brotherhood and mutual cooperation. In this Islamic society, every single Muslim represents a brick in the building of that society. Each and every single brick has its place in the society and it has its responsibility. And when these bricks come together in their proper places and when the people do their responsibilities at this time and only at this time, will we find that the Islamic society will be complete. And will it attain the high place and station that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intended for it? He went on to say, Ikhwan, the believer to his brother Muslim is like a solid cemented structure. The believers are brothers, and each and every one of those brothers, he has a job to do, and he has a role that he must play. And there is no one who can exist by himself, but instead, when we all come together with this understanding, then we become like that life or that body that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. We become the body that is living, the body that is on one iman and one understanding. The Shaykh went on to say that in this hadith, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has informed us that all of our blood is equal, in this hadith. We need to really contemplate this issue because no one is above his brother in this ummah.
He wanted to say that we cannot do without each other. There is no one who can exist by himself. There is no other ummah except the ummah of Al-Islam. He went on to say that the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a deen in which Allah ta'ala has explained every single issue and every single affair connected to the deen, whether it be big or small. And from those issues that have been explained and clarity given to it is this issue of at-ta'awun. So everyone should look forward to being a participant, an active participant, to being the one hand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants for the ummah.
ولكن سأقتصر على بعض جوانبه وأهم مظاهره والأمور التي لا يتم إلا بها. قرر الله في كتابه وأكد رسوله في سنته أن المؤمنين أخوة، فقال تعالى إنما المؤمنون أخوة، وقالت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم المسلم أخو المسلم، لا يظلمه ولا يخذله ولا يسلمه ولا يحقره. يحسن امرئ من الشر أن يحقر أخاه المسلم. الأخوة هذه نعمة عظيمة سببها الإيمان، رابطها حبل الله، يقول الله تبارك وتعالى فأصبحتم بنعمته إخوانا. إذن الأخوة بالله بين المسلمين نعمة من الله، سببها أنهم التقوا على منهج الله، فلا يوجد شيء في هذه الدنيا يستطيع أن يؤلف بين قلوب المسلمين بين قلوب الناس إلا منهج الله. ولو أنفقت ما في الأرض جميعا ما ألفت بين قلوبهم، ولكن الله ألف بين قلوبهم. فيجب على المسلمين، يجب على المؤمنين أن يحافظوا على هذه الأخوة ويتعاونوا على بقاء المحبة والمودة. ولكن إذا حصل شرخ وسط الأخوة ووسط البناء وسط الجسد، فهل نعمق هذا الشرخ؟ هل نعمق هذا الكسر؟ أم نعمل على إصلاحه ونعمل على علاجه ونعمل على إعادته كما كان؟ الجواب في كتاب الله، الجواب في سنة رسول الله. إنما المؤمنون إخوة فاصلحوا بين أخويكم واتقوا الله لعلكم ترحمون. إذا حدث ما يفسد الأخوة ينبغي على المؤمنين أن يصلحوا بين إخوانهم وأن يتقوا الله في إصلاحهم، فإن فعلوا الإصلاح وبتقوى الله نزلت عليهم رحمة الله. وسبب نزول رحمة الله أنهم أعادوا البناء كما كان، وأعادوا الجسم إلى حياته، وأعادوا الأخوة تجري بين المسلمين، فأصبحوا أمة واحدة وأصبحوا جماعة واحدة، والجماعة رحمة والفرقة عذاب. فإذا اجتمعوا على طاعة الله وعلى محبة رسول الله واتباعه استحقوا رحمة الله. إذن الواجب إذا على الأخوة على المسلمين أن يصلحوا فساد ذات بينهم، هذا أهم أمر يجب أن يتعاون فيه المسلمون، يجب أن يتعاون فيه المؤمنون، إصلاح ذات البين. وقد حذر الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم من فساد ذات البين، فقال لا أقول، قال إنها الحالقة، قال لا أقول تحلق الشعر ولكن أقول تحلق الدين، تحلق الدين فساد ذات البين. إذن فإصلاح ذات البين هي إقامة عماد الدين وإقامة الدين وإحياء لهذا الدين. فأول أمر ينبغي أن يكون فيه التعاون أن يقوم الأخوة في إصلاح ذات بينهم وأن يتقوا الله في ذلك وأن يعلموا أن هذا سبب من أسباب نزول رحمة الله عليهم، وكلنا بحاجة إلى رحمة الله تبارك وتعالى، وكلنا بحاجة لأن يكلأنا الله تبارك وتعالى برعاية وحفظه. إنما المؤمنون إخوة فأصلحوا بين أخويكم واتقوا الله لعلكم ترحمون.
The Sheikh would like to say that this issue of cooperation is an issue that is, like all of the other issues that have preceded it, a big issue, a very big topic that's going to be impossible to give its justice and its due right to you today. So what he's going to do is he's going to summarize those aspects of cooperating which are important and which we should not fail to recognize. And he's going to also, inshallah, mention some of the issues concerning this most important fact, that if we did not know these things, we're not going to be successful in being of the people who mutually cooperate. He went on to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the authentic sunnah, they have established a principle, and that principle is extremely important, and it's a principle that you all know, and that is that Allah ta'ala and His Messenger, they have made the believers brothers. And that Allah ta'ala has said in the Quran, verily the believers are brothers. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has told us in an authentic hadith when he said, the Muslim is the brother of another Muslim. The Muslim is the brother of the Muslim. He does not oppress him, nor does he trick him, nor does he give him over to his enemy. And it is enough for a Muslim as an evil act to look at his Muslim brother and to think that he's better than him. The Prophet ﷺ said in establishing this principle, the Muslim is the brother of his Muslim. The Muslims are brothers. He does not oppress him, nor does he trick him, nor does he take him and he hand him over to his enemy. And it is enough as a sin for a Muslim to look at his other Muslim brother and to think that he's better than him. The Sheikh went on to say, this issue is a very important issue, the issue of the brotherhood that Al-Islam has come to establish. Because when we put this rule or the things that will make this brotherhood stronger, this is a reason for us having Iman. And this is a reason that we will be tied with the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is a very important fact that we need to understand, and that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in the Quran that once you were enemies one to another, and then you became brothers by the ni'mah of Allah. The Shaykh went on to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this ayat, he has described the brotherhood that we have been blessed with as a ni'mah or a favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after once being enemies to one another. And he went on to say that the only thing that could have brought us together in this brotherhood is the minhaj of Allah, the way of Allah. And if the people were to take the time out to try to gather and to collect everything that's in the dunya that's worthwhile or that has any substance, and they were to give that, trying to bring the people's hearts together,
The Shaykh went on to say, never would they be able to bring the people's hearts together without the minhaj of Allah. And that's why Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said to the Prophet, and had you spent everything that's in the earth, never would you have been able to bring their hearts together. The Shaykh went on to say, so therefore, my brothers, it is incumbent upon all of us to try and protect this brotherhood and to try and protect this fraternity that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with. He went on to say, if we were to find in this body that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam described when he described our ummah, if we were to find that in this body there was some evil, and we were to find in this body that there was some sickness, or in this structure, this Islamic structure, he said, do we leave it to remain there, or do we begin to do the things that will bring about its Islah, its rectification? Will we do it, or will we bring about the things that will give the answer or the solution to the problem to make the body once again how it was in its original state? The Shaykh went on to say, obviously the answer to that question can be found in the Quran as well as the Sunnah, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about the ayat when he said, and make peace between your brothers and fear Allah in the hope that you will be successful. So he cited this ayat of the Quran showing that whenever there come disagreements and problems between the Muslims, and there's a problem in this body and in this structure, then Allah has told us what we are to do. When he said, and make peace between your brothers and fear Allah in the hope that you will be successful. The Shaykh went on to say that if this facade or if this evil thing was to happen, then we all have to realize that we have a responsibility to a certain degree to come forth and to step forth to make the Islah between our brothers, keeping in mind that we should have the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when we do this, whether we realize it or not, whenever we come forth to make the Islah between the Muslims, this is the reason that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send down His rahmah or His mercy. Because of this ikhwan, when we come forth to make the Islah between the problems, to rectify the problems that have happened, we become reasons that we put the jama'ah back together. The Shaykh went on to say, verily, in the jama'ah, or in being united, there is rahmah and unification. And in being divided, there is azab, or punishment. He went on to say that the Muslims must make this Islah. And the only way that we can make this Islah between ourselves is to have this ta'awun, or this mutual cooperation. He went on to say that of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in a hadith that he wants to rehearse unto you, he has told us the evil of having our ranks in disarray. And that hadith the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said concerning the fasad that comes that in vain between the Muslims, the Prophet said, verily I do not say that it cuts off the hair, meaning the relationship, but I say that it cuts off the deen completely whenever the Muslims have problems amongst themselves. The Shaykh said, so therefore, ikhwan, the very first thing that we need to understand towards this effort of having ta'awun is that we have to make islah between ourselves. We have to rectify mutually those problems that we know that are affecting the ummah, and they are affecting us and individuals. And we have to make this islah with the taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So verily, that's the reason, from the reason, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send His rahmah upon the ummah. For verily, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has said in the Quran, verily the believers, the brothers, so make peace between your brothers.
ولذلك فقد ذم الإسلام قرآنا وسنة، ذم كل أمر يفرق جماعة المسلمين، وذم كل أمر يفسد ذات بينهم. ومن الأمور التي تفرق وتفسد ذات بين المسلمين وتفرق جمعهم وشملهم، أذكر منها أمرين. أولها الحزبية، والحزبية تعني أن تتقطع الأمة الإسلامية إلى فرق وإلى جماعات وإلى أحزاب، كل يظن في نفسه الكمال، وكل يظن في نفسه أنه أمة من دون الناس، وكل يظن نفسه أنه على الحق المبين وغيره على الباطل. وهذه الحال لمها الله تبارك وتعالى فقال تعالى مبينا أن هذا دين المشركين وليس دين المسلمين، حال الكافرين وليس حال المتقين. يقول الله تبارك وتعالى وتقطعوا أمرهم بينهم زبرا، في وصف الكفار، تقطعوا أمرهم دينهم بينهم زبرا، أي جماعات جماعة. ويقول الله تبارك وتعالى ولا تكونوا من المشركين، من الذين فرقوا دينهم وكانوا شيعا، فرقوا دينهم وكانوا شيعا كل حزب بما لديهم فرحون. وفي قراءة متواترة ولا تكونوا من المشركين من الذين فارقوا دينهم، فارقوا دينهم، القراءة الأولى فرقوا والقراءة الثانية فارقوا. ويقول ربنا تبارك وتعالى مخاطبا نبيه ورسوله وحبيبه محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم إن الذين فرقوا دينهم وكانوا شيعا لست منهم في شيء. إذن الحزبية لسنا منها في شيء، لأنها ليست من ديننا، لأنها تفرق جمعنا، لأنها تفسد ذات بيننا. هكذا يعلنها ربنا حربا دروسا على الحزبية وعلى الحزبيين وعلى دعاتهما، لأن هذا الحال ليس من حال المسلمين، ليس من وصف المتقين، ليس من نعت المتبعين. هذه الأمة أمة واحدة. يقول الله تبارك وتعالى إن هذه أمتكم أمة واحدة وأنا ربكم فاعبدون. ويقول أيضا وإن هذه أمتكم أمة واحدة وأنا ربكم فاتقون. وصفنا بأننا أمة واحدة، نعتصم بحبل واحد، نسير على صراط واحد، فمن جاءنا يريد أن يفرق جمعنا ويفسد ذات بيننا فليس منا ولسنا منه. ولو كان للمسلمين شوكة فينبغي عليهم، على أولي الأمر إذا كان لهم شوكة للمسلمين أن يضربوا عنقه. من جاءكم وأمركم جميعا يريد أن يفرقكم فاضربوا عنقه. والأمر الآخر النميمة، وتلك لعمر الله قاصمة الظهر، أن يمتهن الإنسان نقل الكلام بين عباد الله فيفسد القلوب ويشحن النفوس، فإذا بالقلوب قد تنافرت، وإذا بها قد تكسرت، وإذا بالأجساد تدابرت وتنافرت. إن الجنة يا أحبائي مكتوب على بابها لا يدخل الجنة قتاع أينما، لا يدخل الجنة قتاع. والنميمة من الأسباب الموجبة لعذاب القبر قبل عذاب النار. مر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم على قبرين فقال إنهما يعذبان وما يعذبان في كبير وإنه لكبير. أما أحدهما فكان يمشي بالنميمة، وأما الآخر فكان لا يستنزه من البول. وأنا عندما أتأمل هذا الحديث أجد أن الأول الذي مشى بين الناس بالنميمة نجس قلوب الناس، والثاني نجس نفسه، لأن هذا المجتمع مجتمع الإيمان الذي يسير على طريق صحابة رسول الله مجتمع طاهر، مجتمع متطهر، لا يقبل الرجس ولا يقبل النجس، بل ينبذه نبذ النواة. فإياكم أن يستجرنكم الشيطان إلى النميمة، فإنها مفسدة فإنها محطمة لجسور الأخوة. فاتقوا الله وأصلحوا بين أخويكم لعلكم ترحمون يا عباد الله.
The Sheikh went on to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the authentic Sunnah, they have spoken very bad about everything that comes in order to try to divide the Jama'ah, and everything that you can think of that has the opportunity to come to make differences between the Muslims, will find Al-Islam has spoken unfavorably about those things. Everything that can make us to be a people who are divided in our bodies and in our understanding of Islam has come and has spoken very badly about those things. Two things that the Sheikh wants to mention here now, because he said that he finds many of the people participating in these things, and these two things are two of the things that serve as detriment for the unification of the Muslims. He went on to say that the first thing is al-hizbiyya, partisanship, people being with parties, people being with their jama'ah. He said the meaning, or what I mean by al-hizbiyya, is for the Muslim community to begin to break off into different groups, and they start to develop for themselves different jama'ah and different groups. Every single jama'ah that breaks off from the major jama'ah is the ummah, every group that breaks off and away from this major jama'ah, they consider themselves to be complete, and they consider themselves to be the ummah, and they look at everyone else as being astray, and they look at themselves as being the only ones who are on the truth, and everyone else is on other than the truth. He went on to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has spoken badly about this behavior, and he has described this behavior as being the behavior of the kuffar and not the behavior of the believer. As he said in the Quran, and the kuffar broke themselves off and they became different zumara, or different groups. He said that they broke themselves off and they became and developed for themselves different jama'ah. In another ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet, and he said to us, and do not imitate the mushrikeen. Do not be like the mushrikeen. Those people who break themselves off. Those people who divide their religion up. And they become Shia, different groups. Every group is happy with that which it possesses.
every group is happy with that which it is on. The Shaykh went on to say that that's one recitation where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, do not be like the mushrikeen, those who divide their group. And the verb that he used for divide was farraqu. And in another recitation that is mutawatir, it has meaning, it's well known, it's not ambiguous, it's well known amongst the scholars, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and do not be like the mushrikeen, those people who go away from one another and they develop new jama'at, to use the word farraqu. The Shaykh went on to say that that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in yet another ayat of the Quran when he said, verily those people who divide their religion up and they become different groups, and they become different Shiites, different groups, verily you Muhammad, you will not from them. You have nothing to do with them and their way. The Shaykh went on to say that this is what Al-Hizbiyah is. And based upon these ayats, especially the last one, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, verily those who divide themselves up into different groups, and they divide their religion up into different groups, you are not a part of them, Muhammad. This is a clear ayah showing us that we are not a part of the people who are in Hizbiyah, nor are the people of Hizbiyah a part of us. Because this Hizbiyah Ikhwan, what it does is, it does nothing other than to serve the purpose of a shaitan. It causes the heart to become spoiled and no good. And it causes that which is between us, the love that we should have one another, to be non-existent. The Shaykh went on to say that this is a lesson, Ikhwan, for every single group of Hizbiyun, the people who partake in this behavior. And this is a lesson for the du'a, for the people who are calling to Al-Islam. And this is a lesson for those groups, that you have to beware that this is not the characteristic of the people who have taqwa or the mustaqur. This is not the characteristic of the people of this ummah. And for that reason, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala told us in another ayat of the Quran, showing us that the ummah of Muhammad is one ummah, and that this one ummah is not allowed to differentiate amongst itself and to develop for itself different groups. Allah said, verily, this ummah of yours is only one ummah, and I am your Lord, so worship me. In another ayat, Allah said the same thing, verily, this ummah of yours is one ummah, and I am your Lord, so fear me. In the first ayah he said, worship me, fa'abuduni. In the second ayah he said, fattaqun, so fear me. The Shaykh went on to say that we understand from this that this ummah is united and holding on to the cable of Allah, the rope of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all together. And whoever comes and he tries to disunite us or to disorganize us, whether he's from us or from without us, he's not from our ummah. Then if there is an Islamic ruler present from amongst us, it is his responsibility to kill that person. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, if someone comes to you people, and you are united amongst yourselves, then strike that person's neck, kill him. So the Shaykh went on to say, the second affair that will be detrimental to us cooperating with one another and building this one ummah that he feels is necessary to talk about is the issue of an-namima. An-namima is when a person says something, so the person takes what he heard and he takes it to the person who it was said about. Then he comes back and says, like, this is namima. The Shaykh went on to say that the people who are partaking in this issue of namima, hearing things and then going back to people and spreading them and going back, he said that these people do nothing other than they destroy the relationship between the brothers and the connection that people have between themselves, and they cause the nafus, or the people's souls, to start to hate and dislike one another, and it breaks the body, meaning it separates us, and it causes us to want to stay away from one another. He said, for those of you who didn't know, he wants you to know now, that on the door of Jannah, it is written on the door of Paradise, the person who is a khattat will not enter into Paradise. The person who is a khattat will not enter into Paradise. This person is the one who makes namima will not enter into Paradise. The Sheikh went on to say that this is written on the door of paradise, so it goes to show to us, it goes to show us the stability of this affair for you to be a person of namima. The Sheikh said that this issue of namima, whoever from amongst us is partaking in it, you're going to get punished in your grave before you get punished in the hellfire. He said the proof of that is the famous hadith that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was walking and he passed two graves. And then he said to the Sahabas, verily these two people in these two graves are being punished severely. And they are not being punished for something that's major. He said, as for the first one, he's being punished because he used to be a person who went to the people with this namima. He used to hear what this guy said about that guy, so he went to that guy and he told him what this other guy said about him. He said, as for the second person, he's being punished in his grave because he used to urinate and he didn't clean himself properly. He left piss on his clothes. The Sheikh went on to say, I want you brothers to understand something, and that is that when I concentrate on this hadith, I find that the first person, the person who made namima, what he did was he dirtied the hearts of the people by taking this namima. Their hearts were pure and clean. So he took the namima and he dirtied the hearts of the people. As for the second one, obviously, he dirtied himself. So as a result of that, both of them are being punished for the dirt that they created. Because this Islamic society is a society that's built upon Iman. And a society that is on the way of the Sahaba. A society which is pure and which is clean and which cleans and purifies. The Sheikh went on to say, Ikhwan, beware of Shaitan and do not allow Shaitan to make you a person who partakes in the namima. For verily, the namima, it destroys the heart and it burns down the bridges that allow us to become brothers. So fear Allah and make peace between your brothers, and fear Allah and hope that you may have Allah's mercy.
الأمر الثاني التواصي. وقد ذكر الله تبارك وتعالى كلمة التواصي في كتابه أربع مرات، مرتين في سورة البلد وثنتين في سورة العصر. فقال تعالى والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. وقال جل ذكره في سورة البلد وتواصوا بالصبر وتواصوا بالمرحمة. أربعة كلمات جمعت بينها ثلاث حالات. الحال الأولى التواصي بالحق، فالمسلم يوصي أخاه بالحق، والمؤمن يثبت أخاه على الحق، والحق هو كتاب الله وهو سنة. لأن الإنسان إن لم يكن على الحق فهو على الضلال. يقول الله تبارك وتعالى فماذا بعد الحق إلا الضلال، إما حق وإما ضلال. فالمسلم والمؤمن يأخذ بيد أخيه ويجره إلى الحق ويوصيه بالثبات على الحق، بالثبات على كتاب الله وعلى سنة رسول الله وعلى منهج السلف الصالح، منهج الصحابة الكرام والتابعين الأخيار وتابعيهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. لأن الصوارف عن الحق كثيرة، الصوارف عن الحق.
بدأ الإسلام غريبا وسيعود غريبا كما بدأ، فطوبى للغرباء، طوبى للغرباء. في رواية من حديث عبد الله بن عمرو، طوبى للغرباء. أناس صالحون قليل، في أناس سوء كثير، من يعصهم أكثر ممن يطيعهم. هؤلاء الغرباء يتعاونون فيما بينهم، ويوصي بعضهم بعضا على الحق وعلى التمسك بالحق وعلى القبض على الحق، لأن الحق يا أحبائي ثقيل على النفس، تتفلت النفس من الحق. ولذلك وصف الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم القابض على دينه كالقابض على الجمر، كالقابض على الجمر. يقول الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم في حديث أبي ثعلب الخشني الذي يثبت بشواهده وطرق: إن من ورائكم أيام الصبر. هو بدأ بمقدمة طويلة الحديث، قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: مروا بالمعروف وانهوا عن المنكر، حتى إذا رأيتم شحا مطاعا وهوى متبع وإعجاب كل ذي رأي برأيه فدع عنك العامة، فإن من ورائكم أيام الصبر. القابض فيهن على دينه كالقابض على الجمر، القابض فيهن على دينه كالقابض على الجمر. ولا يستطيع الإنسان أن يقبض على الجمر يا أخواني إلا إذا وجد من يعينه على هذا القبض، إلا من وجد من يشجعه على الثبات، إلا من وجد من يشجعه على البقاء على منهج الله.
The Sheikh went on to say that the next thing that he wants to talk about after mentioning the two issues which will cause us to be unable to make this mutual cooperation, he talked about the namima, and then he talked about the hisbiya. The next issue is the issue of tawafi, or the mutual encouragement that we have been encouraged or ordered to give to one another. He would ask us to say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us in the Quran in four places to encourage one another, to make this tawafi. In two ayahs from Surah Al-Balad and in two ayahs from Surah Al-Asr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and he swore by the Asr time, verily mankind is in a state of loss, except those who believe and who do righteous deeds, and they mutually give consultation and advice to one another towards the truth and towards being patient. The point here is that they mutually consult one another and advise one another to be patient on the truth and to be patient on the sabr or patience. The Sheikh went on to say also in Surah Al-Balad, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in these last two ayahs of this surah, and give mutual consultation, give mutual advice to one another on sabr and on having mercy towards one another. The Sheikh went on to say that these four words of tawafi, when it comes in Surah Al-Asr and Surah Al-Balad, it talked about three different things, three different conditions. The first condition is that it talked about giving the tawafi or this advice on the truth or for the truth. He went on to say that the Muslim is one who advises his Muslim brother with the truth. And he is the one who advises his Muslim brother towards the truth. And he is one who helps his Muslim brother to be established upon the truth. He went on to say how? By calling him to the Quran and to the Sunnah and to the way of the Salaf. He went on to say, Ikhwan, that a person is either on one or two things, no third thing. He said the first thing is that the person is either on the truth or the person is on the dalal, or being astray. He said the proof of that is the ayat in the Quran, in that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and after the truth, what is there? Once the truth has appeared,
then what is there other than the truth? Nothing but dalala, that which is astray. The Shaykh went on to say, so therefore, brothers, the Muslim is the one who takes his brother and he grabs him by the hand and he drags him and he helps him and he pulls him towards the truth. And he gives him advice to remain steadfast on the truth and with the truth and by the truth, calling him to the kitab and calling him to the sunnah and to the minhaj of the salaf, the way of the sahabas, the way of the tabi'een, and the way of the atba' al-tabi'een. The Shaykh went on to say, ikhwan, that the things that cause you to leave the truth, there are many, many, many things that will cause you to stray from the truth. He said that the companions of the truth likewise are few. There are many things to lead you away from the truth, and the companions who were firmly established on the truth, they are few. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said in the hadith, verily Islam began as a stranger or began strange, and it's going to return strange. So tuba to the stranger. Then the Shaykh went on to say in another narration, to Abdullah ibn Amr ibn As radiallahu ta'ala anhu, it's a long hadith. And he went on to say in this long hadith, the Prophet started off by saying what we just said, and then he said that there will be people who are righteous at that time when al-Islam comes back. There will be a people who are righteous and they are few. He said, and the people who are against them are many. He went on to say, those who refuse them and those who go against them and disobey them are more than the people who will listen to them. The minority of the people are going to listen to what they have to say. The Shaykh went on to say that we need to cooperate with one another, understanding that this is the first condition of a tawafi, giving this mutual consultation or advice, that we give advice to what? The haq. According to the haq, you tell your Muslim brother to hold on to the truth. You tell your Muslim brother to grab the truth and to squeeze it and not to let go. The Shaykh went on to say that the truth, as far as it is related to the heart, is something that is always trying to run away from your heart. It's trying to escape the person. And the person's nafs has something inside of it that wants to make him always reject the truth. He went on to say, and that's why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in this authentic hadith, the person who wants to hold on to his deen is like the person who wants to hold on to a burning coal. The person who wants to hold on to his deen is like the person who wants to hold on to a burning coal. The Shaykh went on to say that this is a long hadith. It was narrated by Abu Salab al-Khushani radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The beginning of the hadith is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, verily, there are about to come to you people some days when you have to have some sabr, some patience. So when that time comes, each and every one of you, you need to order with that which is good, and you need to prohibit and prevent that which is evil. Because when you see during that time that the person is obeyed and shouldn't be obeyed, and the person is followed who shouldn't be followed, and everyone will be giving their opinion, read the opinions of all of the people and deal with yourself. And then the Prophet said, for verily during that time, the one who is trying to be steadfast on his deen is like the one who is trying to hold on to a burning coal. The Shaykh went on to say that obviously no one can hold on to a burning coal, except if he has people who are behind him saying to him, hold on to that coal, be patient with that coal. He's giving him encouragement and they're giving him good words of advice. So therefore, Ikhwan, our first thing is that we have to make this advice towards the truth.
والأمر الثاني من التواصي التواصي بالصبر. والتواصي بالصبر ذكره الله في سورة العصر وذكره الله في سورة البلد، مما يدل على أهمية الصبر. والصبر كما قالوا كاسمه طعم مذاقه مر مذاقه، ولكن عواقبه أحلى من العسل. فالصبر طعمه مر كاسمه، ولكن عواقب الصبر طيبة، فإن النصر مع الصبر، ومن صبر ظفر. والصبر هام في دين الله، ذكر في كتاب الله 93 مرة. ومعنى الصبر الحبس والكف، والمراد به أن تحبس نفسك على طاعة الله، وأن تحبسها عن محارم الله، وأن ترضى بما قسم الله لك. وإذا نزلت بك مصيبة أن تقول إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون. فالصبر على الطاعة، حبس النفس على الطاعة، والنفس تتفلت، حبس النفس عن المعصية، والصبر عند المصيبة. فيوصي بعضهم بعضا بأن يصبروا، ويوصي بعضهم بعضا ألا يرتدوا، ويوصي بعضهم بعضا ألا ينحرفوا. وهذا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يوصي الأنصار، يضرب لنا قدوة حسنة سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، يوصي أصحابه الأنصار ماذا يقول لهم؟ إنكم سترون بعدي أثرة وأمورا تنكرونها، فاصبروا حتى تلقوني على الحوض. الأنصار يا أحبائي هم أهل الإيثار، الأنصار هم الذين سنوا هذه السنة الحسنة بين المسلمين، ويؤثرون على أنفسهم ولو كان بهم خصاصة، ولو كان بهم حاجة وفاقة، أحدهم يؤثر أخاه على نفسه. هؤلاء أصحاب الإيثار سيجزون بعكس فعلهم على أيدي أهل السوء، سيؤثر عليهم. الأثر عكس الإيثار، الأثر أن تقدم نفسك على غيرك، والإيثار أن تقدم غيرك على نفسك. ما هذا جزاء الإحسان؟ جزاء الإحسان إلا الإحسان. لكنه يصيم رسول أنكم سترون بعدي أثرة وأمورا تنكرونها، فماذا؟ فاصبروا حتى تلقوني على الحوض. وهكذا المسلم يوصي أخاه المسلم بالصبر، بالصبر على الحق، أن تؤدي ما عليك، وأن تؤدي الحق الذي عليك، فإن هدم حقك وإن انتقص قدرك لا ترد الإساءة بإساءة، بل اصبر على الحق. فثمرة الصبر على الحق خير، وثمرة الصبر على الحق كبيرة في الأجر عند الله تبارك وتعالى. وأعظم الصبر أن يصبر الإنسان فلا يشق عصا المسلم، جاء في بعض روايات حديث حذيفة الطويل الصحيح في الصحيحين: الصبر على أئمة الجور. فقال الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم: وإن أكل مالك وجلد ظهرك. يعني من ولاه الله المسلمين، أمر المسلمين، مدام المسلم أمة واحدة، ولو كان الإمام جائرا في أمة الإسلام فلا يجوز الخروج عليه، وإن جلد ظهرك وأكل مالك. هكذا يوصي الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم أصحابه بالصبر على الحق، والمسلم كذلك اقتدى برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يوصي أهله وإخوانه وخاصته بالصبر على الحق فإن أمر الصبر عظيم. وما يلقاها إلا الذين صبروا وما يلقاها إلا ذو حظ عظيم.
The Shaykh went on to say, Ikhwan, that the second issue that he wants to talk about, or the second hal concerning this tawafi, is that these four ayat of the Quran from Surah Al-Asr and Surah Al-Falaq talked about three different conditions. Now he's talking about the second. The first one was tawafi on the haq. Now he's saying that the second issue is the tawafi with the sabr, giving mutual consultation and advice to one another about the importance of being patient. The Shaykh went on to say that these ayahs in Surah Al-Asr and Surah Al-Balad, it shows us when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in both of these ayahs that we should mutually consult one another towards being patient. It shows us that it is extremely important. He went on to say concerning the issue of a sabr or patience. He said that sabr or this patience is extremely sour on the tongue, not palatable. No one likes the taste of it. But even though it is sour on the tongue and difficult to digest, it is sweeter than honey when you get the reward of the results of being patient. Why? Because an-nasr is with the sabr. Victory comes with patience. Whatever affair you're dealing with, whatever it is, if you are patient, you are going to get the nasr or the victory. The Shaykh went on to say that the issue of patience in the Quran is extremely important. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned sabr in the Quran in 93 places of the Quran. And he went on to define for us what sabr is. And he said that it was al-habs wal-qaf, for you to hold back something, to hold something back. He went on to say that it means that you hold yourself back and you order yourself to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When your nafs wants to do whatever it wants to do, you force it to obey the dictates and the orders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it also means that the person is to order himself to stay away from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made haram. And it's also to force yourself to be happy with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated for this nafs. And it's also to be satisfied with what Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has decreed for this nafs. He went on to say that if a person was to be afflicted with a catastrophe, his sabr is saying, verily from Allah we came, and verily to Allah we return. Believing in that statement and understanding that statement, he said that this nafs that we have, the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created it, is that it also has a desire to always run away from us and to be far away from us. But the person has to always try to bring it back to himself, and he has to use it, especially at the time of the catastrophe and the calamity. The Shaykh went on to say, so therefore, Ikhwan, it is our duty as Muslims to apply these ayahs and to encourage one another on being patient. We should encourage one another when we see one another not to renegade and to leave al-Islam, to be a murtad. We should encourage one another not to make the inhiraf or to go outside of what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed. He said, look at what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did with the Ansar. And the Ansar, you all know their position in al-Islam. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to the Ansar, verily you Ansar are going to see after me what is known as al-Ithar, al-Athara on yourself. Meaning there are going to come some people and they are going to put others over you. The Prophet said to the Ansar, verily you are going to see this behavior and you're going to see other affairs that you hate. The Prophet said, so be patient until you meet me at my fountain. The Shaykh went on to say, look at the Ansar, Ikhwan. The Ansar are what is known as Ahlul Ithar, the people of Ithar. And Ithar is when a person puts someone else over himself because they open up the doors
in Medina when the Muhajirin came from Mecca to Medina. The Sheikh went on to say, they are the ones who made this sunnah, to put other people over themselves. Because Allah Ta'ala said in the Quran, in speaking favorably about the Ansar, they are the ones who put other people over themselves, even though their lot may be low. Even though the Ansar do not own anything, what they have is nothing, but in spite of that, they put their brothers over them. The Sheikh went on to say, but the Ansar, they saw from the people the opposite of what they did. The Ansar, they put people over themselves. But the people put themselves over the Ansar. In this hadith that the Prophet said to the Ansar, you're going to see the Athar. So the Sheikh went on to say that the Athar is when you put yourself over someone else. And the Ithar of what the Ansar did is when you put someone else over yourself. And there's a concept in Al-Islam that the Sheikh said, and that is that Al-Ihsan, whoever does something that is good, he will get rewarded in kind. Whoever does something that's evil, he will get rewarded in kind. This is Islamic principle. He went on to say, so we need to be like these people from the Ansar. We need to be a people who advise our brothers, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised them to be patient in the time of the trials and the tribulations. He said, if your haq is taken, or your rights are taken, then what you have to do is you have to go to your brother and you have to tell your brother to be patient. For verily in his patience, there's going to be some good results that's going to come from it, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the greatest forms of sabr, out of all of the different types of sabr that we can exemplify and illustrate, he said one of the greatest forms of patience is a person being patient whenever that patience entails the Muslims staying united. If your patience is going to result in the unification of the Muslims, in the scales of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, this is one of the greatest forms of patience. As the hadith of Hudhayfa has clearly explained to us. This hadith is in Sahih Bukhari and Muslim. And it was talking about the patience that the Prophet ﷺ told us to have when the evil rulers came. The Prophet ﷺ said to Hudhayfa, when these people become your rulers, then listen to them and obey them. Even if they devour your rights, your money, they take from you your money, and even if they whip you on your back, be patient. The Sheikh went on to say, why? Because when the Ummah is one and united, if you're patient, and you do not make khuruj, or you renegade and rebel against these people, you're going to be a cause for the unification of the Muslims, and therefore you're going to be rewarded accordingly by Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ikhwan, has clearly given the nasiha, or he has given this salati to his companion. So we also should do so. We should also give this understanding to our brothers, because we need to also understand that it's going to be difficult though, and that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, and no one will be able to attain it except the one who has sabr. And the one who has attained it has received a tremendous portion.
والأمر الأخير في التواصي هو التواصي بالمرحمة. الله تبارك وتعالى أرحم منا بأنفسنا، أرحم منا بأنفسنا، فيوصينا بأن نرحم بعض، أن يرحم بعضنا بعضا. الله تبارك وتعالى يوصي عباده بأن يرحم بعضهم بعضا، وتواصوا بالمرحمة، لأن من صفات المؤمنين وصفات أتباع سيد المرسلين أنهم رحماء بينهم. محمد رسول الله والذين معه أشداء على الكفار رحماء بينهم أعزة على الكافرين أذلة على المؤمنين، لأنك عندما تقدم النصيحة بالحق والنصيحة بالصبر لأخيك وأنت مشفق عليه وأنت رحيم به وأنت بار به يتقبل هذا النصيحة منك ويتقبل هذه الوصية منك، لأنه يشعر أنك به رحيم وبه بار وعليه مشفق. وكما ذكرنا في بعض مجالسنا في هذا المسجد المبارك أن قبول الحق من أعظم أسبابه أن تقدمه برحمة. يقول الله تعالى: فبما رحمة من الله لنت لهم. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم قبل الناس الحق منه على مضى، بقي 23 سنة يقاتل على الحق ما قبله الناس، ومع ذلك كان بهم برا رحيما. فبما رحمة من الله لنت لهم، فلو كنت فظا غليظ القلب لانفضوا من حولك. إذا يوصينا الله تبارك وتعالى بالرحمة أن نرحم بعضنا بعضا، أن يرحم بعضنا بعضا، أن يشفق بعضنا على بعض. لماذا؟ لقول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: ارحموا من في الأرض يرحمكم من في السماء، ومن لا يرحم لا يرحم، والراحمون يرحمهم الرحمن. فتقدم الوصية لأخيك برحمة، تقدم النصيحة لأخيك بشفقة، تقدم النصيحة لأخيك بستر. إن الله حيي ستير يحب الحياء والستر.
بارك الله فيكم. That the last issue that he wants to talk about today, inshallah, concerning the three حالات of التواصي, is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned making the تواصي on the حق, and then making the تواصي on the صبر, and then making this mutual نصيحة or consultation and advice on المرحمة, having mercy in a merciful way, in a merciful manner. The Shaykh went on to say, brothers in Islam, verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more merciful than we are to us. Allah is more merciful to us than we are to ourselves. So He subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered us to have mercy upon one another. He Himself is more merciful on us than we are to ourselves, and He, Allah ta'ala, has ordered us to have mercy towards and on one another. He said that from the characteristics of those who believe in Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and from the true characteristics of the people who truly believe and follow in the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alayhi wa sallam, is that those people are the ones who have mercy towards the believers. As Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said in the Quran, Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, and those people who are with him are harsh upon the kuffar, and they are merciful between themselves. Muhammad is the messenger of Allah, and those people who are with him, they are harsh against the kuffar, and they are merciful amongst themselves. The Shaykh went on to say, because ikhwan, whenever you give this tawafi or you make this nasiha to your brother, whenever you give it in a nice way, and he sees that you're coming to him to give him this nasiha that Allah told us to give one another, when he sees you doing it in a nice manner and in a soft fashion, then this becomes a reason why he will want to accept from you what you are saying. He went on to say that, but if you feel, or if he feels that you're giving it to him in a way to expose him, or in a way to put him down, then quite naturally he's going to feel the other way. So therefore we should give the nasiha to the person in order to make the person feel that we care about his well-doing, and we care about his condition, and that we are people who are respectful of him and his situation. He went on to say that we said before in this blessed masjid that from the reasons why people accept the truth, but instead from some of the major reasons, one of the major reasons why people accept the truth when it comes to them, and they accept nasiha when it comes to them,
is that people present it in an honorable fashion, in a soft way. The Sheikh went on to say, and that's why Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and verily it was a mercy from Allah that you were soft and kind to them. Had you been harsh and coarse towards them, they would have all run away from you. Meaning the Sahabas and the people. The Sheikh went on to say that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stayed in Mecca calling those people who are hard-hearted, arrogant. He called them to Al-Islam for 13 years in a nice, kind, honorable fashion. From them were those who accepted, and from them were those who rejected. But the point is that he did it continuously and with consistency. So therefore, Ikhwan, Allah Ta'ala has ordered him to be lenient and nice towards the people. So likewise, Ikhwan, we, in following him, have to give this mutual consultation to one another with softness and kindness, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said in the Quran. Whoever has mercy upon he who is in the earth, the one who is in the sky will have mercy upon him. And the one who has no mercy for those who are in the earth, the one who is in the sky will not have mercy upon him. For verily, the Rahimun, or the people who have mercy towards Allah's creatures and creation, verily Allah will have mercy towards them. The Shaykh went on to say, Ikhwan, so therefore we should put forth this nasiha and this tawafi on this with a nice preaching and a nice behavior, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, verily Allah is hay, satir. Allah ta'ala is alive and he covers things. And he loves modesty and shyness, and he loves that you cover one another's faults and not expose one another.
وأختم هذا الدرس، وإن كان عند الأخوة أسئلة نجيب عليها بعد صلاة المغرب. أختم هذا الأمر بتنبيه هام. أن الناس الآن يعيشون في حالتين: حالة الفوضى وحالة الحزبية. بعض الناس ينكرون الحزبية، في المقابل ردة الفعل كانت عندهم الفوضى. وبعض الناس ينكرون الفوضى فصار عندهم الحزبية. والتعاون وسط، لأن دين الله وسط بين الغالب والجافع، وسط بين الفوضى وبين الحزبية، وسط. فالمسلم والمؤمن يعتقد أنه لا يمكن أن يقوم بحمل هذا الدين لوحده، ولا يمكن أن يقوم بتغيير المنكر بوحده بنفسه. لذلك هو بحاجة إلى أن يتعاون مع إخوانه في الأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر وإقامة دين الله تبارك وتعالى. ولكن لا يتحزب ولا يخلق حزبا جديدا وجماعة جديدة وفرقة في جسم الأمة فينسلخ بذلك عن الأمة، بل يتعاون مع إخوانه في الله. وأقصد هنا، أنبه، أنني أقصد بالتعاون التعاون بين أصحاب المنهج الواحد، ولا نتحدث الآن عن التعاون الذي يقال ويطرح بين الجماعات وبين الأحزاب وبين الفرق. أنا أتحدث عن التعاون بين أصحاب المنهج الواحد، لأن أول أمر من مقومات التعاون
هو الاعتصام بحبل الله. قال الله تعالى: واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا ولا تتفرقوا. هذا المقوم الأول وهو العمود الفقري للتعاون. واعتصموا بحبل الله جميعا، الذي يريد أن يتعاون أول ما يتعاون أن يضع يده في العروة الوسطى، حبل الله لا انفصام له. أما الذي لا يضع يده في حبل الله ولا يتمسك بالعروة الوسطى فلا يمكن أن نضع أيدينا بيده. الأمر الآخر أن هذا التعاون ينبغي أن يقوده أهل العلم وليس أهل الجهل والسفه. وانظروا إلى هذه الحقيقة التي كان يدركها أهل الجاهلية ولكن أدعياء الإسلام لا يدركونها. يقول الأفوة الأودي وهو شاعر من شعراء الجاهلية: لا يصلح القوم فوضى لا سرات لهم. أمر الفوضى لا يصلح الناس، لا يصلح القوم فوضى لا سرات لهم. ثم يقول ماذا؟ ولا سرات لهم إذا جهالهم سادوا. إذن المعادلة متوازنة، الفوضى لا تصلح الناس، إذن لابد أن يكون للناس قيادة ربانية ولا قيادة حقيقية إذا قادها الجهال، لأن الجهال يتلاعبون بالأمة تلاعب الأطفال. الأمر الثالث أن التعاون لا يترك للظروف. أنشط أتعاون مع إخواني، أكسل أتركهم وأفر عنهم. التعاون لابد أن يكون فيه متابعة. فرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم كان إذا آمن الرجل ما تركه هكذا، تابعه ورباه وعلمه وحرضه على الحق حتى تكاتف الناس حول رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. إذن التعاون لا يترك للظروف. يقول بعض الأخوة: نحن نتعاون. كيف تتعاون مع أخي وأنت لم تره كل سنة مرة، ولم تتصل به ولا هاتف، ولا تسأل عن حاله ولا عن وضعه ولا عن دعوته؟ هذا ليس تعاون يا أخواني. التعاون لا يترك للظروف، التعاون لا بد له من استمرارية، متابعة. أن يتابع العالم تلاميذه، أن يتعهد الأخ إخوانه، أن يتعاون الدعاة مع بعضهم البعض، لكن دون رئيس ومرؤوس، دون أمير نطاع، ودون بيعة، ودون إذا خرج منا خلاص ارتد عن الإسلام. وهذا هو قول الله تبارك وتعالى: وتعاونوا على البر والتقوى ولا تعاونوا على الإثم والعدوان. وأفضل كتاب قرأته في هذه الآية هي الرسالة التبوكية لابن القيم ابن الجوزية رحمه الله، ابن القيم الجوزية رحمه الله تلميذ شيخ الإسلام. ومن رحمة الله بكم الأخوة الذين لا ينطقون باللغة العربية، فأنا رأيت أن الرسالة مترجمة، ليس كذلك؟ مترجمة إلى اللغة الإنجليزية، وهذا من فضل الله عليكم.
ومترجم
أي نعم. وجزاكم الله خير.
The Sheikh finished and we're going to make salat now inshallah ta'ala. He finished by saying, in conclusion, ikhwan, he's going to answer some questions after salat al-maghrib. He said he wants to point out a very important point
a very important issue, and that is that the people we find are living and their life is of one of two situations. The first one is that there are those who are living in confusion or in phoba. And the other way is that there are those who are living in this hizbiya that was spoken about previously, people being with groups and parties. He went on to say, as for the people who live the life of the hizbiya, they refuse the life of confusion, so they go to the other extreme and they become hizbiya. And the people who choose to live for themselves the life of confusion, they refuse the life of the hizbiya, so they go to the other extreme. The Sheikh went on to say that we need to understand that the ta'awun, or the mutual cooperation that we're looking for, that's supported by Islam, is the cooperation that's going to put you in the middle away from the confusion, and in the middle away from the hizbiya. The Sheikh went on to say that the Muslim must believe that it's impossible for him, virtually impossible, and he cannot fool himself. He must believe that it's impossible for him to carry this deen by himself. It's impossible for him to change all of the munkar that is present by himself. So therefore, he has to make the ta'awun, or the mutual cooperation with his brothers, so that he can change the munkar, and so that he can establish the religion. The Sheikh went on to say, but he makes this ta'awun without the tahazzub, without being a part of these groups. He said he does not also, by the same token, when he wants to go out to develop a new or to establish the deen, by cooperating with his brothers, he does not make tahazzub, and he also does not create a new group. He went on to say, but what he should do is he should be careful of what he's doing. And this ta'awun that he's talking about, he went on to explain it and to clarify so that people won't misunderstand. He said that the cooperation that I'm talking about is the mutual cooperation that you brothers should have with the people who are on the proper minhaj. The people are on one minhaj, one way. He went on to say, and I'm not talking about this mutual cooperation where you cooperate with any jama'ah or any group or any firqa, any of these groups. He wanted to say, because ikhwan, in making this ta'awun, in making this mutual cooperation, if we want to be successful in doing it, then the very first thing we need to understand concerning it is that the ta'awun has to be according to what Allah Ta'ala has sent down. And you can't do that with groups that are not practicing or understanding Islam properly, as Allah Ta'ala said in the Quran, and hold on all together to the cable of Allah and do not divide amongst yourselves. The Shaykh went on to say, so the first thing that we need to understand is, in making this mutual cooperation, we have to all hold on to the rope of Allah, meaning the way of Allah, and not the way of these different jama'ah. The Shaykh went on to say, ikhwan, that we have to put our hands in the hands of the people who are on the same minhaj, and he does not say that it is allowed for a person to put his hand with other than those people. He went on to say that, this is very important, ikhwan, he said that this mutual cooperation, it has to be led by the people of knowledge. There have to be amongst us people of knowledge who are in the position of giving advice and giving guidance, and not the people of ignorance in the times of Jahiliyyah. It's sad that the people of Jahiliyyah, they understood this point, but we don't understand this point. He said that the man said in poetry in the times of Jahiliyyah, he said that there is no islah or no benefit, the people will get no benefit from the confusion, from the fold up. And they will get no benefit if the people who are leading them are the foolish ones. He said they will have no power. لا يصلح
قال اصلحهم قال اصلحهم لا صراط لا قادة لهم ولا صراط لهم لا قادة.
The people will get no benefit if their affairs are confused, and they will have no leaders if that's their situation. And the people who will not be successful, who their leaders are the foolish ones from amongst them. So the Shaykh went on to say that, to show us the point that the people who are responsible for showing us how and who to make this ta'awun with, they have to be the people of knowledge. Because if we leave the...